Hello everyone, Reed Duke here. Welcome to a vintage cube draft video here on channelfireball.com. Today I'm playing not just a vintage cube draft league, but this is actually a scheduled event. It's a 64 player draft where if you go 3-0 in your first draft, you draft again for, you know, basically cut to top 8 to try to advance further in the event. So the difference between what you're probably used to in my videos is this is going to be single elimination. So I'll play as far as I can get until I lose one. Anyway, getting right into the pack here. There's no power card, so less than ideal. But some strong options include Elvish Mystic, Breeding Pool, Creeping Tar Pit. Well, any of the lands, I'd say. So Elvish Mystic, any of the lands, Narset, Parter of Veils, maybe Liliana or Snuff Out, but I'm leaning against those. I think it's going to be either Elvish Mystic or Narset. Perhaps I'll try Elvish Mystic. There was a time when I would draft blue in most of my cube drafts, but now I think the colors are a bit more balanced, where once I've missed out on the opportunity to get, like, Ancestral Recall, Time Walk, Mana Drain, then I think things are pretty balanced, and I'm not going to take, like, Narset's pretty good and definitely has some combos with the draw sevens, but I'm happy to just lock in the really good cheap card in green and see where things go from there. So following up, the best green card is probably Deep Forest Hermit. No, I guess the best green card, quote-unquote green card, is going to be Skull Clamp. Though Deep Forest Hermit and Survival of the Fittest are both interesting. Other standout cards, Fury and Shieldred. So pretty strong pack. Pack one, pick one, I think I would take either Fury or Shieldred over Skull Clamp. The question is whether having the first pick, Elvish Mystic, moves the needle enough. Boy, I could still just see taking Fury, and then I could either build red-green, which Minsk and Boo, if I'm fortunate enough to get that, is one of the best gold cards in the cube, or I could just have two different paths that I could go down in terms of green or red. But Skull Clamp's good too. All right, let's take Fury. Following up on Fury, I think I'll take Dak Faden. So not really working out with the first pick Elvish Mystic so far, but Fury and Dak Faden is certainly a good start to a blue-red shell. There's this Itali Primal Conqueror. I feel like that's more of like a reanimator type of card than a I'm going to play some mountains in my deck and cast this kind of card. I don't know, the Augur's okay, the Might Stone, the Weak Stone's okay, but I think Dak Faden is a standout card in terms of power level. While we're here, I want to thank you all for tuning into this video. Remember, you can pair this with some written content over at channelfireball.com. We've had LSV writing actually some guides and highlights about Vintage Cube, so if this is your favorite format, Luis is certainly a player you want to pay attention to because he has been drafting a ton and he's got some really, really good write-ups about both his general draft strategy and some of the more kind of difficult to process, tricky cards in the cube. So what do I have to work with this pack? It looks like I should take a red card, either the Char or the Dragon's Rage Channeler. I like both. When I draft a red aggressive deck, it's my priorities are kind of like burn spells and one drops and then everything else, so I'd be really happy with either the Channeler to get out of the gates early or the Char to give me some reach. I think I'm gonna go with the Channeler because I think if I do wind up with a blue red mid-range deck, while both cards would be fine, I'll probably be a little bit happier to have the Channeler. So let's go there. Gitaxian Probe versus Hellrider. Thing with Gitaxian Probe is you can just play this in mono red or anything. So if this was like consider, you know, some kind of different non-colorless blue cantrip, I would probably take Hellrider because I still want to keep the door open for just going mono red aggro. But probe is nice in blue red, it's nice in mono red. Heck, I could go mono green and still be able to put Gitaxian Probe in my deck if I want. So I will go with that one. I'm going to take Chain Lightning over Daze, Snapcaster, Time Warp. Again, if mono red is just open and I'm getting hit in the face with late aggressive red cards, I want to be able to do that. So while there's probably a world where I go blue red and my finished product would rather have Snapcaster Mage than a Chain Lightning, I think it's best to just take the red card here. I'm glad to have gotten away from green. Maybe I could have put something together if I'd gone Elvish Mystic, Skullclamp, then taken like Eternal Witness. But I would rather go green if it's super open, and that does not seem to be the case. I'm also missing a red card from this pack. I don't really love the Stowaway or the Snap. The Porcelain Legionnaire is fine in mono red. Could also take Inspiring Vantage, but let's go with the Legionnaire. But I really want to see a red card so that I can know, you know, we're full speed ahead in terms of drafting the strategy. I'm not getting that. I'm not getting the late Sulfuric Vortex or the late Goblin Guide. So maybe I will take Fairy Mastermind and hedge my bets in terms of like a blue-red mid-range or a blue-red tempo. If I was mono-red, Mutavault's pretty good and Metamorphose is fine, but this is a pretty large power level difference, and I'm worried about the world where I'm not going to get there in mono red. Okay, so what's missing from this pack? I took the Elvish Mystic, someone took the Liliana, several lands missing, I think three lands missing. What else was I considering? The Snuff Out is still here. I mean, is there any way I get back to red-green from this position? I don't know what to take. I actually decided to take Creeping Tar Pit. Maybe I go blue-red and want to splash a black card or something. Here, Fiery Islet. That's fine. Naturally, someone took Shouldred, someone took Skullclamp. Itali, Bitter Reunion, a second black dual land is kind of interesting. The way this deck is shaping up, I'm not just going to put a 7-mana card in my deck. Bitter Reunion is, I guess, fine card selection. If I want to fill my graveyard, if I want Delirium. All right, Char came around. That's kind of the first bit of good news that I've had in the whole draft. A little bit of an exaggeration there, but this was a twisty, turny draft, and I feel like it hasn't been super obvious what my lane is just yet. I don't think Paradoxical Outcome is that good of a card, and I also don't think it's shaping up to be very likely that I could play it. Anduril, that's a fine card if I need a playable, or if I want to sideboard it in for a slow matchup or something like that. All right, now we're in business. The Mox Sapphire is just what the doctor ordered. In a different world, you know, Tinker is interesting. I did pick up the Bolas of Citadel late in the first pack. But yeah, I mean, I have Mox Sapphire in a pack where there's no other standout card for me, so this is just great. Probably won't wheel Tinker or Upheaval. Venser's a fine playable card. You know, Through the Breach, Blightsteel Colossus can get interesting under the right circumstances. I did pick up late Inspiring Vantage if I want to splash something like Showdown of the Skalds, but really nothing to talk about from the Mox Sapphire pack. And what have we here? Dismember is fine. Fable the Mirror Breaker is great. I imagine I'm going to take that. I wouldn't have minded speculating on Brain Freeze, since that can be really good if you get Underworld Breach, or if you take a slight fork in the road where you wind up a little bit more combo-y. Or I even had a blue-red draft the other day where I was just sideboarding in Brain Freeze for slow matchups where it's like, okay, Brain Freeze you for 12 or 15 cards, you know, at the end of a control mirror match type game. But Fable the Mirror Breaker is absolutely premium. I'm going to take that. Now we have several great options with these three on the bottom of your screen here. Scalding Tarn, Smuggler's Copter, and Treachery being the most exciting. You know, Svalon, Nahiri's Warcrafting, maybe even Hangerback Walker. Those could all make my deck, but I think these three on the bottom are the best. Scalding Tarn is probably just too important. I mean, okay. Let's do a reality check. Is there any way that I get away from blue in this draft? I have Fairy Mastermind and Dak and Probe and Mock Sapphire. The Probe and the Mock Sapphire could still go in mono red. I mean, I'm probably just going to go blue-red, but I don't know what to take here. I'm going to take Scalding Tarn. But I could really see any of those three being correct. Here we have Trinket Mage with just Mock Sapphire. That's fine, but I think I like the other options better. More looking at Magda or Miscalculation. If I had taken the Smuggler's Copter, the Magda would be very appealing. But I think if I'm certain that I'm going to be blue-red, Miscalculation probably the best card. Mystic Confluence, Wheel of Fortune, Mizzix's Mastery. Fallen Shinobi, that's the black card that I could see splashing, though I think given that I have some good options in my colors, I will probably not take that. I think Mystic Confluence is the easiest card to use. You know, Wheel of Fortune, as Mizzix's Mastery, and Displacer Kitten, they all have really high upsides in the right deck, but Mystic Confluence, you can just throw it in any deck with blue mana, and it's going to be good. And I don't really think I have the positioning to take full use of take full advantage of any of these three combo style cards. So Mystic Confluence it is. This is another blue-red dual land, though not the best of them. Hard Evidence is cool. Firebolt's cool. Relic of Progenitus is useful. I guess I'll go for the Triome. So I think there's a world where I could have taken Smuggler's Copter, then Magda, then I'm not sure what from the last pack, then Firebolt, and I'd still be open to mono red, but I think at this point I'm blue red and I'm just going to take the dual land. Just move this Porcelain Legionnaire over. That makes the mana curve look a little bit better. Okay, a Braid over Murktide Regent and Brazen Borrower. If there's ever a good deck for Murktide and Brazen Borrower, it's probably something like this, but I do think a Braid is like kind of a higher value and less replaceable card. I don't know, it's a pretty good deck for Murktide Regent. Like I could play this for 3 or 4 mana as a 5/5 flying pretty often. But I think I'll still take a Braid. Brazen Borrower would be my third choice personally. I'm not in love with that card. Though this is, like I said, a fine deck for it. Alright, in mono red, my ranking would probably be like Bowmat, and then Squee, and then Burst Lightning. In blue red, I think Burst Lightning might actually be the best of them. Alright, here's another white-red dual land in case I get Fourth Aer Lingus in pack 3. I could also take the Showdown. But I think I like taking the Jetmir's Gardens because if I do somehow decide wind up splashing white or green. This provides double duty alongside the Scalding Tarn. So I think that's a nice kind of speculative pick. All right, Brain Freeze came around, as did Splinter Twin. Both are becoming kind of interesting for me. If I had taken Wheel of Fortune, I'd take Brain Freeze, but I think Splinter Twin is nice and easy, especially it has Wheeled, so that indicates nobody else is really going for that strategy. So if Pestermite or Deceiver Exarch or Zealous Conscripts is opened in Pack 3, I have a pretty high chance of getting it. All right, I'll take the Warcrafting over the Svealon. Ooh, Trinket Mage or Magda. If I was to get a second target for Trinket Mage, it would be better than Magda. But I think with just the cards I have in front of me, I prefer the hard-hitting 2-drop. Okay, Mind Collapse is fine. Oh, baby! That's a gift. That is perfect. Pick 15, Murktide Regent. Nobody likes 5/5 Flying Dragons anymore. Okay. So opening pack 3. Solemn and Treasure Cruise are like fine marginal quality cards. Goldspan Dragon is good. Misty Rainforest is technically a dual land alongside the Ketria Triome. Light Up the Stage, Thirst for Discovery, Mana Leak. So I think my ranking here is probably like Mana Leak, then Thirst, then Misty, then Goldspan, then Light Up the Stage, then like some of these other marginal picks. But I think I'm going to take the Mana Leak and hopefully wheel something useful from the pack. So here's another blue-red duel. Jace Friend's Prodigy is a good card. That would go in my deck for sure. I would be slamming it if I had Ancestral Recall or Time Walk, but I don't. Robber of the Rich, fine, but weaker than Jace. Then Jitte, Brainstorm. So I think I'm looking at Triome, Jitte, or Brainstorm here. It's probably got to be the Jitte. I think I have enough creatures to make this worthwhile. I think it's enough better than Anduril also. Might wheel something good from this pack too. Like Brainstorm, Robber, Jace, Triome. Okay, Ponder. Inferno Titan, Jace, Lelia, Steam Vents. Wow. Really putting me to the test here with some really nice cards. I think Lelia is the best of them. I think my ranking would be like Lelia, Steam Vents, Ponder, Jace, Inferno Titan. Which, that's crazy. Like, look how far we've come where I'm drafting a blue deck and Jace the Mind Sculptor is the fourth best card in the pack for me. I do still think Jace is quite good, and I'm playing this in any deck with blue mana if it ends up in my pile, but it's just not a priority anymore since there are so many great things to do at 4 mana at sorcery speed, and my deck doesn't even have a lot of fast mana. If I had like a Mana Crypt or a Soul Ring, then I'd be more interested in just the power out a quick Planeswalker plan, but I think I'll take the cheaper, hasty creature there. Barall's fine. Force of Negation's better. Phantasmal Image is fine. I think pretty clear Force of Negation here. Come on, let's get a Pestermite or Deceiver Exarch. I know no one else at the table is taking them. Where are they? Oh, wow. I like that even more than a Deceiver Exarch. Mana Drain is one of my absolute favorite cards in the cube. I have this as, you know, just one of the top, like, never pass type of cards. That is just a huge gift. I did not think I would be getting something this powerful this late in the draft. So that's amazing. Orcish Bowmaster is also a super, super strong card, but obviously not my colors. In a different world, I would have been pretty happy with the Foothills or the Grim Lavamancer, but man, Mana Drain, amazing. Counterspell too, likewise, just a great, great, great card. Yep, easy Counterspell. So now I'm finally feeling good about my colors, my archetype, like getting the pick 15 Murktide, then a couple late Counterspells. As I said, I think I have a good chance of wheeling, you know, one or two playable cards towards the end of the pack, so all good for me. Yeah, look, I have five Counterspells, six Counterspells if you count the Mystic Confluence, so it's usually difficult to get that many in this cube. Goblin Guide. So I did already miss out on both Mizzix's Mastery and Torrential Gearhulk, which means Magma Opus is probably not going to be that useful. Actually, Escape to the Wilds is kind of interesting because I'm going to be playing the Khetria Triome and the Scalding Tarn anyway. So that's not that far-fetched for me to just play that as a value card. I don't think this is going to be quite a Goblin Guide deck, more like a blue-red mid-range or tempo deck. Compared to a mono red aggro. So let's take the Escape to the Wilds and we'll see what happens with that one. Right, so here's a blue green dual land. Chart a Course, Monastery Swift Spear, Factor Fiction. Probably Chart a Course is going to be the best. I don't think I'm quite aggressive enough for the Swift Spear, and a lot of my spells are counter spells. So like Swift Spear attack for one and then pass on turn two is not that exciting. I think Chart a Course, no, I'm going to take Factor Fiction. I think I have enough counter spells that I'm going to be passing with open mana pretty often. But man, we went the whole draft without seeing a Pestermite or a Deceiver Exarch, unless there was one in pack one that I forgot about. But I'm thrilled with the Thirst for Discovery. I think I'm actually just blue-red control now with the pass with open mana game plan. Lelia is actually kind of awkward with so many of my cards being counter spells, so maybe that was should have been a Ponder or a Jace or a Steam Vents or something. Brainstorm over Robber, I'm loving that. Oh, Steam Vents came around. Lovely. Is this a Barral deck? I mean, it's more likely to be Barral than any of these other cards, so I'll just take that, and we're gonna have to do some surgery once we get to deck building here. Omnath, I mean, with Jetmir's Gardens and Khetria Triome, stranger things have happened, but I don't think I'm gonna use Omnath. Well, we'll see. Just put these in, and I'll just go to the deck building screen and then find out exactly what I want this 40 card monstrosity to trim down into. I mean, I'm clearly not going to play Splinter Twin. I imagine I'm going to play Jitte, but not Anduril. Well, first let's see what it looks like if I'm just plain blue-red control. Does Char make the cut in blue-red control? Probably not. I think Lelia and Fable do. Warcrafting also does, though Lelia and Warcrafting have both lost value after I put so many counterspells in my deck. That was probably, you know, less than ideal drafting and deck building on my part. If it's your turn, you may sacrifice a mountain rather than pay the spell's mana cost. 5 damage to a creature or planeswalker. It's not the best ever, but it's okay. So this is a 22 card blue-red control deck that's gonna win with Murktide, Fury, Lelia, Fable, Fairy Mastermind. It's not... I would love to have a few more win conditions. It's only 4 creatures in this version too, so I need more creatures to play the Jitte, but I have Dragon's Rage Channeler, Grim Lavamancer, Magda as options. I imagine the channeler is just going to make the cut. Probably the Lavamancer too. So the Barral reduces the mana cost of Confluence, Factor Fiction, Mind Collapse, Thirst for Discovery, Warcrafting. Barral does a lot, plus the looting from the permission. Man, this is gonna be hard to get to to get to 40 cards to trim it down to a 40 card deck in the end. Magda, I feel like I'll probably not start Magda, just board her in when I'm on the play or against an opponent who can't block well. So, without any splashes, I'm playing it like this, or I have a Ketria Triome. Double splashing the Omnath, that there's just no way. However, the Escape to the Wilds is interesting. Also loses value with so many counter spells. Maybe I'll skip that, just keep it simple, because I don't need to touch into another color to get 40 cards I'm happy with. Bitter Reunion is good for Delirium. Otherwise, not very special. This is a 16 or a 17 lander. I'm sure I can get away with 16. I have the Mox, I have a couple cantrips. Question is, do I want to get away with 16? I also have a couple of looting effects, so probably not gonna be flooded too much. But no, probably 16 lands plus the Mox is gonna be appropriate here. So right now I have 27 cards. Need to cut three. Mind Collapse, Char. I think the Warcrafting is good enough just to, find a land drop or something. Think Barral is going to be good too. Man, how am I gonna make cuts? With seven creatures plus the Fable, how good is the Jitte? It seems pretty good to me. I got flash creatures, I got flying creatures. So laid out here, I have 25 non-land cards. Could cut Factor Fiction. Kind of like it though, because it fits with the plan of passing with open mana. It fills the graveyard for Channeler, Lavamancer, and Murktide. If I'm really forcing myself to make cuts, the Warcrafting, the Jitte, I've convinced myself that the Barral is going to be good. I also want to have some mana sinks for the mana drain. This is not the best mana drain deck in the world. That's another reason to keep Factor Fiction in the deck. I think Lavamancer is going to be good for me too. I don't think I can cut one of these one mana burn spells. Maybe the Warcrafting is just not making the cut then? Is this a deck where it could be appropriate to go above 40 cards? I am going to churn through my deck pretty often. I could see a world where I'd have trouble winning the game in a long game. Yeah, so I guess I've convinced myself that these are my best 40 cards, like this with 16 lands. So, Now I'm thinking about, is there any world where I want to just play like 1742 and get Nahiri's Warcrafting into the deck? I'm gonna draw a lot of cards. I do not have a lot of creatures. I could see a world where, like, I have to trade off some of my stuff, or, I have to loot away a threat, and then my opponent has a heavy removal deck, and I just get to the end of my library, and I'm like, oh, I wish I had a little more action. But I'm not talking about getting another threat into my deck. I'm talking about getting Nahiri's Warcrafting into my deck. I can always play a Murktide and protect it with a counterspell. All right, I'm just going to keep it simple. Play the 40-card deck. So adding, I think, a roughly equal split of mountains and islands. I do have one, two. I have one, two, three. Three, four, five double blue cards, only one double red card, but I have some cheap red spells. I'll go one more island. So this gives me. Oh, I have the Mox Sapphire too. So this would give me 12 blue and 9 red. I'd rather go 11, 10. It's pretty close. Yeah, I'm on board with the 12. 12-9. Like I just outlined, I think there's going to be worlds where I want to have four blue mana for like Murktide Regen and pass with a counterspell. So yeah, I think this is my deck. I'm going to submit this. I'm going to wait for deck building to be over, and then I will see you for round one. All right, friends, welcome to match number one of today's Vintage Cube Draft. From first pick, Elvish Mystic to blue-red control. Tempo, what do you want to call this? But at any rate, I am on the play with a pretty nice hand. Let's keep. And I'm just going to start on Mountain plus Dragon's Rage Channeler. And then probably fetch Island and play Jitte on turn two. Only thing awkward is I have the Force of Negation with no blue card to pair with it yet, but even if you just look at the six cards on the left, this is a really good hand. Or at least a really good hand against certain opponents. Let's do it. So, pretty sure my opponent's gonna not block if I attack. This is what I would call a semi-bluff because I don't really want to trade off my only creature when I have the Umezawa's Jitte, but I think it's likely enough, like much greater than 50-50, that I just get in a free damage here. So I'm gonna take the opportunity to get a free damage. If they do block and trade, it's maybe slightly not preferred for me, but it's definitely not a disaster. And then, if I knew for sure that they were going to trade, I guess I would not attack. But if I was offering the trade, it would be best to play the Jitte first to get the surveil. But I just thought that would change their decision enough that it's better to do it post combat. So pretty interesting turn for only being turn two there. Yep. So it really seems like I want to just equip and get this tree speaker dead. There was a snuff out in the draft, which would be very bad for me if they have that and I spend my turn doing the Jitte, but I don't know that it's makes sense for me to play around it. I think it's more. It's funny because like when you talk about playing conservatively, playing around things, you want to kind of plan for the worst case scenario, which would be me equipping and my opponent having snuff out. On the other hand, it's not really a conservative play to just let my opponent untap with Jiraga Tree Speaker either. So I think I should just make the play that is sensible on the board of equipping, attacking, and killing that mana dork. Man, I had the feeling about the snuff out. Just kind of seems like they have it. No? All right, they didn't have it. Beautiful. Well, die, Jiraga Tree Speaker. You are much too scary to stay alive. Upkeep, Vampiric Tutor. Yep, I'll allow that. Even though I do have Force of Negation, I think I should hopefully Force of Negation something different. Yes, that is what I will Force of Negation, please. I think playing Lelia has to be right. Nice, I even hit something that I can cast. Sure. They did have Emrakul to go with the channel. As it is, they have Furrow. Of course, they can survival into something different to play. Yep. Opponent has a cool deck. It's definitely pretty scary. So 7, 11, 12, 13. Get pretty close to lethal here. Whenever one or more cards are put into exile from your library and/or your graveyard. Wow! So Grim Lavamancer plus Lelia is a combo? I did not know that. I knew I've had the combo of like Bomat Courier plus Lelia before, but I didn't know she triggered on things exiling from your graveyard. So also a combo with Murktide Regent. Oh, but I just pumped down my Dragon's Rage Channeler, so I actually was counterproductive there. All right, we're learning, we're learning. Okay, so moving to sideboarding. I'm guessing I want more cards that kill creatures. So Char, Nahiri's Warcrafting, and Mind Collapse. Not cutting any of these. So you can see, like, that game illustrated why the Jitte is better than the Anduril. That wasn't a game where I wanted to just purely race. It was a game where I wanted to kill their mana dorks and make sure nothing bad happened. Fairy Mastermind is just too good. I think Dak Faden is too good to cut. Maybe Mind Collapse is not good enough, but bringing in these two. Is there anything else I can possibly cut from this deck? Like Fairy Mastermind, if I knew for sure they had zero card drawing, but they have Uro, so that's already enough for the Fairy Mastermind. The Dak Faden, if I knew for sure they had zero artifacts, maybe. Like I said, I want to keep the Thirst, the Factor Fiction, and the Mystic Confluence because they're just good cards. They let me pass with mana open, and they work well with mana drain. I kind of like the Char because in theory it could help me beat Channel, but maybe that's too pie in the sky. So if I bring in the Warcrafting, does that make me want to switch an island for a mountain? Pretty close. Sure. If I have to kill mana dorks, I do not want to be missing my mountain early. Sure, I can work with this hand. All right, just pay two life for the probe. So there's a few options here. I could pay mana for the probe. I could wait on the probe, which having the Force of Negation kind of cuts both ways in that I might want the probe to pitch the Force of Negation, but I also would love to have information about my opponent's hand. So all things considered, I am going to use the probe. I'm valuing the information, plus I might draw into a one-drop creature. Who knows? And we have Breeding Pool, Garrick, Dismember, Augur, Survival. So I can let the Survival resolve. The Survival's good in their deck because they can always, like, just filter through, get the Uro in the graveyard, pitch a bunch of creatures. But I think I want to save the Force of Negation for the Garrick or possibly even the Dismember. Got it. So I feel like I'm going to let the auger resolve and just play the Fairy Mastermind, but maybe I should take a beat to think about this. Yeah. I think I'm okay with this. So then Lelia, attack for 5. They're going to untap. If they play the Garrick, trying to get greedy with the Dismember, I can force a negation the Garrick, then I have a big advantage. More likely, they'll probably just Dismember the Lelia. Yeah, I don't know. I like just playing my creatures and having 2 so that the Dismember can't totally shut me down. The Augur with the Survival is kind of a nice combo because they can shuffle their library a few times till they find a land on top to guarantee the card advantage. So that came off the top, that Tropical Island. 5 cards in hand. Yep, so I'm going to force a negation that, and then I get another turn before the Dismember can be cast. This even pumps the Lelia, so I can't quite get her to 6/6, which would be awesome, but getting close. Interesting. Interesting sequencing opportunity here. I think I should start with Brainstorm and then put something on top that I can exile and cast with Lelia. There's also the Scalding Tarn. Let's start with Brainstorm, see what happens. Oh boy. All right. Mana Drain. Jitte. So how about put back Mountain, Scalding Tarn, attack, play the Scalding Tarn off the Lelia. Pass with Mana Drain available. That all sounds pretty good to me. Shuffle away the Mountain. That's a forest played off the top, yeah. Dismember and unknown cards in hand. My opponent typed, forces are too good. So is that... No, I guess that's not a concession. It's just a face value comment there. Mox Pearl, you have a Mox Pearl. Natural Order. Well, that's a good Mana Drain target. Yep. All right, this just in. Counter spells are good in Cube Draft. All right, I advance to the second round. Don't miss it. All right, everybody, I'm back for match number two of this Vintage Cube Draft. Blue-red tempo felt pretty good in the first match, and here I am on the draw, but with a really good hand. So let's do it. With this hand, I'm probably going to lead on untapped steam vents because it just looks like from the texture of my hand that thing's going to come in untapped sooner or later, so might as well make it sooner. The one counter argument is Wasteland, where maybe you want to go Mountain, Channeler, and then steam vents on turn two, but well, I'll think a little bit more about that. At any rate, my opponent is ahead of me and has mulliganed to five cards. Two black green mages. That's an unusual color combination in cube, and certainly unusual to have multiples at the same table. Okay, so mountain or steam vents? Okay, I guess I'll go for the mountain. And then probe right away, might as well. Kind of hurts to bin that fable. But if you think like I would draw the fable, play bar all, then on turn three I have to brainstorm and miss my play. I think it's good to put it in the graveyard. It also is very, very good for getting delirium, and the damage output is something that I do value. Okay, so we have Yawgmoth, Ophiomancer, and Razor Verge Thicket. So that's actually quite a strong five card hand, but I can let the Ophiomancer come down and then evoke Fury on turn two. So this is all fine for now. Yep. I could brainstorm, which has the advantage that it can help me hit a third land and can maybe give me more information about a red card to pitch with Fury. If I don't hit a land, if I just play Barral and then don't hit a land, I don't really have a play for next turn. So I think I am going to choose to brainstorm. It will also guarantee delirium, which is a nice side benefit. Yes, so I can top that. Once I evoke the Fury, I'm going to have delirium anyway, so all good. Right. So one Yawgmoth, one unknown card in hand for the opponent. I'm going to evoke the Fury pitching either Dak Fadin or Grim Lavamancer. If I don't cast the Dak, I can just hold up Mana Drain. So I kind of like playing Lavamancer, pitching Dak, passing with Mana Drain the following turn. The Lavamancer has a little bit of tension with the Delirium of the Dragon's Rage Channeler, but this seems like a player who's got Mana Dork, so the Lavamancer is pretty strong. Okay, so we're going to go with Mountain second from the bottom because I might wind up surveilling that away. So Mountain, then Mana Drain, then evoke Fury with the Dak. One, two, one. Then swing for three. Play a Lavamancer, and then unless my opponent has found something really special, I should just be able to sit back on Mana Drain and be in great shape. Rankle. Still getting mana drained. Island. Do I play the Barl? Doesn't really matter. Just draw three. Yeah, that's a top. So then I could play Lelia, attack for seven. If they play Yawgmoth, that's still fine. Or I could just attack for four, pass with Mana Leak. Doesn't seem like I could go wrong either way. What's the worst that can happen if I do play Lelia? It's cube drafts. So there's a lot of bad things that can happen. But with only one card, is there anything that's worse than like a creature sweeper? Yeah, I think it's probably right to pass with Mana Leak, but choosing between two really favorable situations here. I guess this is right because I just have lethal now with the Lelia and the Chain Lightning. All right, well, that was really good. I'm guessing I want everything that kills Yawgmoth and Rankle, which would be these three red cards. Pretty similar sideboarding to last time, but I think it's even more important to have those red burn spells because of how strong Yawgmoth is. Then a lot of my creatures, it's like Grimlovmancer is bad against Yawgmoth, but probably great against the rest of my opponent's deck. So I can cut the Barl. Similarly, like Fairy Mastermind's very bad against Yawgmoth. Force of Negation. I literally saw all creatures from my opponent, but this card is really good. But maybe this is the one matchup where it's okay to board it out. What else? The Mastermind, the Jitte is so good, and the Mastermind makes the Jitte so good. I don't really want to cut that. There's the DAC fade-in thing, like no information about whether this player has artifacts or not. Oh man, so hard to make cuts. Man, I might just register 41, which it's really hard for that to be correct, but I'm just totally at a loss of what I can cut. Maybe Lelia on the draw, but I don't really want to do that. Well, I'm going to keep. Five mana source is a lot for this deck, but the, you know, any hand with Mox is just so strong, and it only takes drawing one creature for this to just be an amazing hand. One creature or one card draw spell. Yeah, that'll do. So I'm guessing passing with miscalculation is going to be appropriate here. Agatha's Soul Cauldron. That's not immediately very scary, but I feel like it could get scary. And I'm just going to use my mana while I can and miscalculation that. Whoa, that's my cat knocking my camera around. All right, here we go. Okay, I guess it's a race. I like my chances in the race given that I have Umezawa's Jitte. Right, so am I using the counters right away or just sitting tight? I think I'm gonna sit tight. At least wait until my opponent's declare attacker step. Yeah, go ahead. It's gonna be Yawgmoth. If it's Yawgmoth, I probably want to kill the goblin tokens in response. Yeah, that seems right to me. Although I'm threatening an attack for 9, so it's pretty tough for my opponent to not block. If they have no life gain or removal. Yeah, maybe I just let that thing go, and then a likely turn is I attack, they block, they sack the two goblin tokens to draw. No, I guess I should just kill the tokens. Don't want to let them get too many resources to pair with that Yawgmoth. Man, I was really hoping for a little more action this turn. Yuck. All right, I guess I'm probably just killing this in the beginning of combat step. Maybe not. Feel like this game would be easier if I just had one more non-land card to play. All right, land go. Well, I've never beaten this card before. Flying Lifelink Haste. I don't like any of that. Whenever it attacks, you get an experience counter, then you get a 2-2 red rebel that's tapped and attacking. Ouch. All right. The only good news is that they don't have anything that can block Lelia super well. Like, they might choose to leave the Squee back. My life total is getting a little low for comfort also. Okay, so that's excellent. Nahiri's Warcrafting on the Yawgmoth is how it's going to start here. That gives a counter to Lelia. Can't imagine they can... What? They just conceded? That does not seem right. It didn't... I mean, I could see conceding if they hadn't processed the lifelink from Othari. But here it's like, if I want to remove both blockers, it takes the counters off my Jitte. Then I get them to, like, what, 3 or 2 or something. But then they're threatening to kill me on the crackback. I think that was a premature concession. I think I was going to get a couple looks off the top of my library to find something helpful. But, yeah, I mean, I was considering that to still be a pretty close game. Anyway, I'll take it. So I'm now one win away from advancing to the second draft. Let's see if I can pull it off. Hello and welcome back for the third and final match of this cube draft. If I win this match, I advance to do a second draft. If I lose, I'm out. That's it. And I'm against legendary Magic Online player Eken. This player is very frequently the trophy leader when you look at these like limited draft leagues. And I actually lost to Eken in one of these events yesterday. So tough finals opponent, but I'm ready. And I have a pretty good hand, with the only tension being, you know, it wants to go Mountain Lavamancer, and then I won't have double blue for Mana Drain, but certainly going to keep... Actually, if my first draw step is Island, I'll just play Island and skip the Lavamancer. We'll see how it plays out. I guess it's most awkward if my second draw step is an Island. All right, opponent Mulligan's ahead of me. Oh boy, yep, Caracas Sol Ring. There you go. So this is the big turn. This is the shields down turn where my opponent can play a 4-mana crazy planeswalker or something. All right, that is good, but not so good that it's impossible for me to win. So interestingly, I have this Abrade, which can destroy either the Golem token or the Sol Ring. Feel like I want to get the Sol Ring. The Golem beats Lelia in combat, but in practice the Golem probably attacks me and then Lelia can attack back and then eventually grow to a 4-4. Probably doesn't even matter anyway, because the Caracas takes care of Lelia, so maybe that's not my plan. Maybe my plan is I have to sit back, play control with like Thirst, Mana Drain, eventually Mystic Confluence bounces the token. But I think I probably want to abrade the Sol Ring, just make sure nothing crazy happens before I'm prepared. Oh, come on. All right. So once again, just this is not an option against the Caracas, so my only real play this turn is to pass with Thirst for Discovery available, but I'm going to need some very serious help to keep pace with this. Also note the Caracas defends the Adeline from removal. So I'm looking at 9, 10, 11 damage. I mean, I guess. Okay, so I probably want a situation where I'm threatening a Dragon's Rage Channeler with Delirium. I have instant covered in the graveyard. Land, creature, it's tough to get Delirium, I guess. Well, at any rate, I probably have to play Channeler plus Burst Lightning plus activate Lavamancer on my next turn. In which case, I could discard Lelia Mana Drain or something like that. Huh. In a slightly different world, that would be interesting. Anyway, Mountain, Channeler, go. Cast Burst Lightning targeting Adeline. See what I surveil into. Then line up blocks. Shoot the Adeline. I probably just have no outs anyway. I could bounce three things, but I'm at one, so not quite good enough. Yeah, that was tough. Probably need to be on the play to have a chance in that game. Okay, so Porcelain Legionnaire is actually okay against creature decks. You know, if I just put that onto the battlefield and it makes a lot of my opponent's creatures unable to attack. But pretty much we're looking at the same sideboarding that I've had of all the red cards coming in. In theory, it should be kind of an okay matchup. I have the Lavamancer, I have the Jitte, just got to keep Adeline off the battlefield. So Force of Negation, I mean, I did lose to creatures, but they can definitely have some very scary non-creature cards. DAC, but against the Soul Ring. I think Baral seems okay. Like 1-3 body is not the worst. Okay. So the Warcrafting has to be in. The mind collapse has to be in. The char kills Adeline, which is a very big deal. So Lelia is like pretty bad if I have to block, and pretty bad against Caracas. It is just a great card though. I guess Barral has the Caracas thing as well. I think on the draw, I'm comfortable sideboarding out Lelia, but maybe on the play, it's just too good. Yeah, Barral, I guess, is marginal, and against the Caracas, that's enough for me to take it out. More creatures is good for maximizing the Jitte. Shall we try this? And then... Oh, wait. And yeah, try this. And then for game three on the draw, maybe like the DAC and the Lelia swap out for, I don't know, Factor Fiction and Force of Negation, something like that. Yep. This is as good a start I can ask for. Alright, I feel like I want a main phase Brainstorm, because if I hit a fourth land, then I can pass with Mana Leak available. If I don't hit a fourth land, then I want to just cast the Jitte. Though there's a problem that if my opponent plays another creature, they can just block and give protection, and I can't connect with the Jitte anyway. Interesting. So I guess I want to pass with Mana Leak basically no matter what. All right, so let's just go land, attack, and pass. Glimmer Lens for Mirrodin. Whenever equipped creature and at least one other creature attack, draw a card. So the interesting thing here is if my opponent needs to give this protection from white, it will make the Glimmer Lens fall off. I guess that's not that big of a deal. And I'm almost surely mana leaking anyway. But let's respond with Brainstorm. Perfect, perfect. So I kind of want to keep all these cards. I guess the Mind Collapse is the one that I can shuffle away. So put back Mind Collapse and Chain Lightning. Mana Leak this, then I'm going Scalding Tarn for Mountain and connecting with the Jitte. This is a good start against the creature deck. I think I just pass. Gideon, yeah. So end step, I have to kill the Giver because, once again, if my opponent's able to block with a protection from white creature, that's not going to go well for me. Okay, and then attack Gideon. Chain Lightning Gideon and then drop the Murktide. Okay, so Flicker Wisp is going to reset the Murktide back to a 3-3. I think I'm just going to kill the Flicker Wisp and attack for what? For 8? Yeah, that seems good. Lavamancer can potentially combo with Murktide, but all right. Well, that if that had to be good enough, because if connecting with Jitte that quickly on the play was not good enough, this was going to be a rough match. But anyway, game three on the draw. So I think I want the Force of Negation. Talked about the problem with the legendary creatures against Caracas. So I think I'm considering basically just these three blue-red control type of cards. The Porcelain Legionnaire was fine that game, or I mean, it was good that game with the Jitte. I think Lelia's got to be out. Still not sure about Dak. I mean, in theory, it's very good against the Sol Ring, and my opponent could have more than that. But in practice, I think I'm going to be behind by the time I'm casting Dak, so it's hard to imagine getting like a ton of value from it. So basically choosing 4 from among these 6. I really do want the Force of Negation, just insurance against a quick Gideon or Armageddon or whatever it might be. The Mastermind and the Legionnaire are fine. And then do I want Dak, Char, or Factor Fiction as my last card? I guess I'll go for Char. I mean, I just have to kill Adeline or Gideon or whatever my opponent's biggest threat is. Okay, here we go. Match 3, game 3 for all the marbles. I guess the Force of Negation can kind of count as interaction, so I can keep this. Like, Force of Negation to prevent the absolute worst case scenario, and then turn 2 Porcelain, hopefully turn 3 Fable. Now, am I going to Force of Negation a Black Lotus or a Sol Ring? That's the $1 million question. Thankfully, it doesn't come to that. Okay. I'm even fortunate enough to hit a 1-mana creature. There's the Char. That was my 40th card. I wonder if it would have been better as... Doesn't look like it would be better as Factor Fiction. Well, maybe just because Factor Fiction can pitch to Force... Caracas, so it would not be better as Baral or Lelia. Yep, take the 1. My opponent maybe with the slightly slower draw. That's good news for me. Yep. So this is going to be Adeline protected by Giver of Runes and Caracas. Really need to hit my third land here. Oh, come on. All right. Well, it's not, I guess, the worst. Just tag the Giver, which I will do right now. Yeah, I got to top that. So at least the Legionnaire can hold off the tokens. Imagine I just have to char this. In theory, if I can get a Murktide. Maybe I can stabilize. So I'm going to char the Boonbringer Valkyrie, block the token with First Strike. That means Adeline's going to be representing a 4/5 creature. I'm going to be at 11. Oh, yes, no attack with Adeline. That is really good news for me. So, yeah, it's fine. Line up this block here, char the Flyer. Sure. Fury. Okay, so Fury can't hurt the Adeline. It can basically trade against the Blade Splicer. Creature in my graveyard doesn't do much. Seems like I definitely just want to cast the Fable and then hope that next turn I can make a Murktide Regent. All right, so that's interesting. That does guarantee me double blue for next turn. It's also a good card type to have in the graveyard. It could, in theory, allow a hard cast Fury, and then I would have enough first strike damage to block the Adeline. So I think on balance, I just need to top that. It would not give me Delirium for what that's worth. I only have instant and creature right now. Okay, so this is the real scary turn. And then after this, I get to start playing Furies and Murktides and hoping to stabilize the situation. I have Force of Negation to prevent probably like the absolute worst case scenarios, but if they play a big threatening creature, like anything similar to the Boonbringer Valkyrie, then it can get ugly. I don't particularly want to cast Force of Negation because I want to be able to loot and have enough resources to have like land drop plus Mox and the Fury. Hopefully my opponent just has a bunch of planes that, you know, the City of Traders is making him not use. Well, have to Force a Negation, have to pitch Mana Drain, have to top the Mox. Yeah, still would not have Delirium if I put the Mox in the graveyard. This can come down as a 6/6. So this makes sense, which we'd have first strike damage, we trade. Then I would take 8 down to 3. Put artifact in the graveyard for the channeler. I could just jump the Adeline with the channeler right now. But no, I think this makes sense. Okay, I imagine I'm just gonna keep all of this. Then I'm gonna pass through combat so I don't have to attack with the Dragon's Rage Channeler. Play the Mox, Surveil. Graveyard will give me Delirium. Do I want Delirium? Do I care about Delirium? I guess I'm taking away the Delirium anyway because of the Murktide. I want to be able to cast the Fury, but I can make that happen by attacking with the Goblin Shaman token. I think it's Graveyard. Please just have three planes in your hand. Alright. Looks like I'm gonna have to settle for 2-1 in this draft. So the only thing I can do is chump. So all I have to do is pay the 4 life, and then I don't have 2 blockers, and that's that. Well, it was a good run. I hope you enjoyed the video. I certainly enjoyed bringing it to you, and I will see you next time here on ChannelFireball.com.